Shalom. I want to first and foremost give all the praises, glory, and honor unto Yahweh Bashem, Yahushua Bashem, Rabbi Chakwadash. Double honors to the elder apostles of the great millstone who rule well. Peace, blessings, and salutations to the hopeful elect tabernacle of David scattered throughout the four corners of the earth. And I want you brothers out there to beware of this doctrine, which can only really come from a non-Messianic Israelite, basically a Old Testament Israelite. But the doctrine is the son of the Most High is Michael the Archangel. And this little video right here that I caught, it's bringing out the account where Joshua, all right, which was the leader that the Lord rose up, under Moses to deliver Israel, out of the wilderness into the promised land, which was the land of Canaan. And when you go to Joshua, the fifth chapter, it shows that he had an encounter with a divine entity. And because he's referred to as the captain of the Lord's host, that insinuates that that would have to be Michael because he's the prince. Michael is referred to as the prince. So when you read this chapter, this is after Joshua, got the generation that came out, they was able to get circumcised, and then they kept the Passover. And then right after that, you had this divine entity, this angel, appeared, right before Joshua with a sword in his hand. So before I even get into that, I'm gonna just play this video, and you can watch it so you can see the argument that this individual is posing. And this is supposed to be proof that Yahweh Shai is not the son of the Most High, but Michael. So let's play this real quick, and then let's really evaluate the scriptures.
Cheese.
right, so I'm sure y'all got to, see it through as I played it, so you can see all the points that's being made and what scriptures is being used, and certain passages that are being highlighted to make a point. Now, one thing with these non-Messianic Israelites, in which the Lord pretty much blinded them, which is why they can't see the Messiah, all throughout, the Old Testament. Matter of fact, let me get a quick scripture. And this is what happens to a lot of these Old Testament Israelites. Is it in this chapter? Let me see real quick. Yeah, here it is. Yep, 2 Corinthians 3. And I'm going to start at verse 13. It says, "And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished, but their minds were blinded. For unto this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in a Mashiach. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon their heart." So when they read the law, they still got that veil over their mind. So they really can't see Yahweh Shai, even though he's clearly in the book. All right, like it says in Psalms 40, and also reiterated by Apostle Paul in Hebrews, the 10th chapter. "For lo, I come in a volume of the book, it is written of me." All right, the Lord comes in a volume, so he's had many cameos, all right, that you didn't catch in the scriptures because the Lord had blinded you. And it's and the Lord blinded those who he wanted, because you have those who are the elect and those who aren't. Let's get Romans 11 and 7. And it says, "What then? Israel have not obtained that which he seeketh for, but the election have obtained it, and the rest were blinded. According as it is written, the Most High have given them the spirit of slumber, eyes that they should not see, and ears that they should not hear until this day. And David said, Let their table be made a snare, and a trap, and a stumbling block, and a recompense unto them. Let their eyes be darkened, that they may not see, and bow down their back alway." And that's two-thirds of our people that can't really get it. All right, and Yahweh Shai is that rock that our people are offended at and stumble over. And I'm talking about the ones who don't believe. All right, mainly I'm talking about the non-Messianic Israelites. Let's get 1 Peter 1 real quick. Let's start at verse 6. And it says, "Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious." And that's talking about Yahweh Shai. "And he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, then the same is made the head of the corner." Or Yahweh Shai, he's the cornerstone that they reject. "And a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed." So it was already predestined for these individuals to not believe. All right, so when you don't believe on Yahweh Shai, guess what? He blocks that understanding. All right, Yahweh Shai is the only way to this understanding, and he's the one that grants you the Holy Spirit to be able to understand both the Old and the New Testament. All right, so this guy right here, whoever made this video, he's stumbling and he's blinded. He thinks that Michael is the son of the Most High. He's the Messiah. All right, and he's using Joshua, that account in Joshua. So let's go to that real quick. And let's really see if that's talking about Michael the Archangel. This is Joshua 5. And we're going to jump down. Now, mind you, before this encounter, Israel got circumcised. They got circumcised and they kept the Passover. All right. You read the first 11, 12 verses. They were circumcised and they kept the Passover. And I believe that in itself is spiritual. Now, Apostle Paul, he mentions how we compare spiritual things with spiritual. Let me get that in the 1 Corinthians, the second chapter. Because, this is going to go over, these guys that are blinded, is going to go over their heads. But the brothers, the believers who the Holy Spirit is upon, are definitely going to, they definitely understand this. This is 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 13, it says, which things also we speak, not in words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. And one of the spiritual things I want to highlight concerning this chapter is how, notice, once they had, the Passover and they got circumcised, then this angel, this the captain of the host of the Lord, shows up. Now, who ultimately is our Passover and who's ultimately our circumcision? I got two precepts. First one, let's get a Colossians 2. Start at verse 10. Matter of fact, let me start at 8. It says, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after a Mashiach. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. All right, and who, what's a part of the principality and the powers? The angels. The Lord had authority over the angels and the demons because he has preeminence. All right, all things were made by him. Okay. It says, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision, and this is to the Israelites in Colossae, which these were Israelites that were living in foreign lands that were considered strangers, right? Those who were circumcised in Judea, they looked at these Israelites that were living in these other provinces as uncircumcised due to the Hellenization. But they were brought back. All right. It says, made without hands and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Mashiach. All right. So ultimately, once they came into this gospel and forsook their sins and were cleansed of their sins, they were spiritually, they were circumcised. The scriptures talk about the circumcision of the heart. And through HaMashiach, Yahweh Shai, our minds are circumcised. All right? You become a new creature in Yahweh Shai. You cut off the old man, you trim the fat off when, because you were dead in your sins. Being uncircumcised, it represents a sin. And you could read that in Romans, the second chapter. Once you break the law, your circumcision become uncircumcision. So through Yahweh Shai, we were circumcised. All right. So that's the correlation that I find with this, even though this was going back to the times of when we were under the old covenant, when we were physically getting circumcised because that was, part of that the covenant. All right, you have to be circumcised in order to eat of the Passover. And let's prove that Yahushua is also our Passover. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 5. And was it 6? Yeah, it says, your glorying is not good. Know you not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? Purge out therefore the old leaven, right? That old man that was, filled with sin, that you may be a new lump as you are unleavened. For even HaMashiach, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. All right? And when we keep the Passover now, we do shew the Lord's death, because he is the sacrificial lamb. We eat of the lamb, we break the bread, we eat the unleavened bread, which represents the New Testament, and also we drink his blood, which is we drink the Yayan, which represents his blood. You see? So going back to the time of Joshua, whose name happened to be Yahawashai, which means he is the savior, he is the deliverer. How is it that this angel comes right to him right after the circumcision and the Passover? Right? I just thought that was spiritual that he shows up, right after these deeds were done. And this was right before we was getting ready to go into Jericho. All right. So let's read Joshua 5 and 13. It says, and it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho, that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, art thou for us or for our adversaries? Because he had not he didn't know, because Joshua, him being a chief officer over Israel at the time, he had a responsibility, to protect Israel. So he was seeing if who this man that was standing with the with that sword in his hand, is he there for smoke or is he there, to help? Because they was getting ready to go in to Jericho to take it over. They was about to fight with them Canaanites. It says, and he said, nay, but as a captain of the host of the Lord am I now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship, and said unto him, what saith my Lord unto his servant? So the very first thing he does after he actually addresses him as the captain of the host, the armies of the Lord, Joshua falls directly to his face. Now, all the other men of the Lord, when they had encounters with angels, there most of the time an angel would actually have to tell that particular prophet to basically get up. Don't worship me because I'm your fellow servant. Let's get an example of that. So what type of captain is this? What type of angel is this? Let's go to Revelation 19. This, the most notable one. This is John on the Isle of Patmos. Revelation 19, verse 10. And I fell at his feet to worship him, and he said unto me, see thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant, and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Yahushua. Worship the Most High, for the testimony of Yahushua is the spirit of prophecy. So this angel, he denied the worship. Okay? Because you're not to worship the angels. Let's get another account. Let's go to Revelation 22 and verse 7. It says, behold, I come quickly. Hold on, let me see something. Yep. There's a message from Yahushua, but this is an angel here, a representative. Revelation 22 and 7 is what Yahushua had said. Behold, I come quickly, blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. And I, John, saw these things and heard them. And when I heard and seen, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel which showed me these things. Then said he unto me, See thou do it not, for I am thy fellow servant, and of thy brethren the prophets, and of them which keep the sayings of this book, worship the Most High. So this angel kept rejecting the worship of John. John, you know, he kept telling him to basically stop worshiping me. All right. And let's get a epistle from Paul, which admonishes brothers, you know, not to get carried away with, you know, philosophies from different men who were bringing in heresies, you know, around them. You know, men thought that you were closer to the Most High if you practice asceticism, and if you worship the angels, that brought you close to the Most High. But that's going off. Colossians 2 and 18. And it says, let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he have not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, and not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and hands, having nourishment, ministered and knit together, increased with the increase of the Most High. Wherefore, if you be dead with a mashiach from the rudiments of the world, why, as though living in the world, are you subject to ordinances? All right, but the point was in verse 18. All right, we're not to be worshiping these are angels. All right, but there's been accounts when Yahweh Shai received worshiped, and he didn't stop them. Let's see if we're going to find an account of that. All I have to do is type in worshiping, and all these precepts come up. Matthew 18:26, Matthew 28:9, it says that, and as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Yahweh Shai met them, saying, All hail, and they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Let's see if he stopped them from worshiping him. Let's go further into this account and see if he stopped them. Then said Yahusha unto them, Be not afraid, go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me. So he didn't tell them to get up like the angel did. All right. 17, jumping down to verse 17. The Great Commission says, Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, Matthew 28:16. Into a mountain where Yahweh Shai had appointed them, and when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. All right, and Yahweh Shai didn't stop them. Okay, he came back in his glory. Okay, and you go even into the Old Testament, scriptures say, "Kiss the Son, lest he be angry." That's in Psalms, the second chapter. All right, and in the ancient world, they would kiss an idol as a form of or a token of worship. But Yahweh Shai, he's the express image of the Heavenly Father. So it's not idolatry when you worship His Son. Yahweh Shai, it's like the Most High Yahweh recommends it. But let them OT. Now, Messianic Israelites tell it, and that's why they're gonna have to give an account to him that's gonna judge, because the Lord committed all judgment unto the Son. Anyway, so you know these are all the different accounts where Yahweh Shai was worshipped. Okay, so let's go back. And let's read it again. It says, verse 14, it says, And he said, Nay, but as captain of the host of the Lord I am come. Now, it's actually true that when you go into this word captain in the Hebrew, the word is shar, which means prince. And yes, Michael, the archangel, he is a prince. He's referred to as the prince. He's the one of the chief princes of the angels of the Lord. But who's the prince of princes? Who's over the prince? Which one of the angels did the Lord say come and worship him? Was it Michael? Let's go to Hebrews, first chapter. It is Hebrews 1 and 1. It says, the Most High, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, having these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he have appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Now that's why even David prophesied, the Lord said unto my Lord, sit down on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. So who was David talking about? All right, it says verse 4, it says, being much made so much better than the angels, all right, Michael included, as he have by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than David. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee, and again I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. All right, and that's also in Psalms, the second chapter. In the same chapter, where he says, "Kiss the son, lest he be angry." All right, but let's continue. And again, when he bringeth the first begotten into the world, he saith, "And let all the angels of the Most High worship him." So all the angels, they're servants of Yahweh. It says, "And of the angels, he saith, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire." Okay, so the angels, they minister to Yahweh. You even had when right before Yahweh was getting ready to get crucified, when he was in the garden, he prayed for the Lord to take away that cup from him, but the Lord, didn't answer him. When instead an angel came and ministered to him. All right, so the angels, they serve Yahweh, because they know that Yahweh is their Lord. All right, and this is the same Yahweh that also said this, by the way. I think it's in was it John, or it might be in Matthew, whichever account. Yep, so it's the one in Matthew. All right, Matthew 26 and 53. This is Yahweh speaking. All right, so you tell me who's the captain, the prince of all the angels, or who has command over the angels like that, right? This is Matthew 26 and verse. I'll start at 50. It says, and Yahweh said unto him, friend, wherefore art thou come? Then came they and laid hand on Yahweh and took him. And behold, one of them which were with Hamashiach, Yahweh, stretched out his hand and drew his sword and struck a servant of the high priest's and smote his ear, smote off his ear. Then said Yahweh unto him, put up again thy sword into his place. For all they that take the sword shall perish with the sword. Thinkest thou that I cannot now pray to my father, and he shall presently give me more than 12 legions of angels? That means that he got that kind of authority. Okay, he has that kind of command where he could just call on the Father to send some troops down for him, just like that. All right? That ain't ordinary. It says, but how then shall the scriptures be fulfilled, thus that thus it must be? Okay? So we see here that Yahushua, he has command over the angels. If he can actually call for the Heavenly Father to send down more than 12 legions of them. And then besides, when he shows up, when he returns, let's go to Revelation 19. Let's go back to Revelation 19. We're going to read verse 11. And it says, and I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called faithful and true, and in righteousness he doeth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of the Most High. And the armies, all right, the host which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. All right, so the Lord came with them heavenly troops. He came with the armies, man. All right. And yes, Michael is going to be present when we read Revelation 12 and 7, where it talks about there being war in heaven. Well, Michael is going to be at the command of Yahushua, tearing shit up, tearing up them NATO troops and all those armies that are assembled over there in the Middle East during the height of the War of Armageddon. Michael gonna be getting busy, but at the command of Yahushua. All right. But this shows right here, these accounts shows that he would be more so the captain that fits, this encounter, so to speak. All right. And then he also in this video brought out Exodus 3, where he called Moses out of that burning bush, and he told him to take off his sandals. The ground that you're standing upon is holy ground. So that lets you know that this wasn't no ordinary angel, because all the other angels, they're gonna tell you, "Hey, get up," you know. Some angels, they're gonna come, and you also have a hierarchy of angels as well. Okay. You got the principalities. So this wasn't an ordinary angel. This had to have been the Messiah, all right, in his pre-incarnation, but in his he came in bodily form, but he was still angelic. All right, and this was kind of like a cameo, but it was a foreshadowing. All right, because he decides to show up right before we about to go and spy out. Well, not spy out because it was already spied out, but we're getting ready to go and take the Holy Land, the promise. All right, so that was kind of like a stamp for Joshua to be the savior, to lead Israel into the promised land. Okay. It says, and the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place wherein thou standest is holy. And Joshua did so. All right, that was the son of the Most High, man. That wasn't Michael. All right, Michael, he constantly getting busy. Michael doesn't, he didn't come down, all right, which, you can search it out, but we ain't seen accounts of Michael actually coming to a prophet and a prophet, bowing down and worshiping him. You ain't gonna find that nowhere. Okay, so this, through the process of elimination, would have to be talking about the Messiah. And then he also quoted Exodus, was the 23rd chapter. And this is another scripture we show to prove that this is talking about the Messiah as well. This ain't talking about Michael. Where are they getting this from? And where's the correlation in that? And notice it spells angel with a capital A right here. This is Exodus 23 and 20 says, "Behold, I send an angel before thee to keep thee in the way and to bring thee into the place which I have prepared." All right. And notice that angel, he showed up with to Joshua right before they was getting ready to go into the place where that the Lord prepared. Beware of him and obey his voice. Provoke him not. Don't provoke him. For he will not pardon your transgression. So you telling me that Michael, all right, the great prince, he has the power to remit sins. It says, "For my name is in him." Basically, I place this authority upon him. I give him this authority that he can actually remit sins. Come on, man. Only the Heavenly Father was able to do that. But he's giving permission to this one angel right here. They ain't talking about Michael. Stop. All right, it says, "But if thou shalt indeed obey his voice and do all that I speak, then I will be an enemy unto thy enemies and an adversary to thine adversaries." All right. And that's, you know, going back to Joshua when he asked him, you know, "Are you for us or are you for our adversaries?" Well, he was actually coming to be for us and against our adversaries. Okay. Now, you can even tie in the correlation with we go to the account in Matthew, the 17th chapter. This is Matthew 17 and 1. It says, "And after 6 days, Yahweh Shai taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah talking with them. Then answered Peter and said unto Yahweh Shai, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here three tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." Now, it was holographic images of them, and they were seen basically talking with Yahweh Shai. All right. "While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of the cloud, which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him." Right, in other words, listen to his voice. All right? Hearken unto him. Okay? Because he's the law and the prophets. Okay? So we were always to obey his voice. Let's get another one. If you will not hear his voice, this is another scripture. He's also that prophet. Deuteronomy 18 and 15, it says, "The Lord thy power will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like unto me. Unto him you shall hearken." Better hearken to his voice, according to all that thou desirest of the Lord thy power in Horeb, in the day of the assembly, saying, "Let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my power, neither let me see this great fire any more, that I die not." And the Lord said unto me, "They have well spoken that which they have spoken. I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto me, and I will put my words in his mouth. And he shall speak unto them that I shall command him. And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak, and my name," right? Because his name is in him, "I will require it of him." Okay? And Yahweh Shai was the fulfillment of that. But if you are a non-Messianic Israelite, you got that veil over your eyes and you can't see that he, that Yahweh Shai with the fulfillment of that. John 1 and verse 44. Yeah, John 1 and 44 says, now Philip was of Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip findeth Nathanael and saith unto him, we have found him of whom Moses and the law and the prophets did write, Yahushua of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. Okay. And he's referred to Deuteronomy 18 and 15. All right, and also in other various scriptures in the prophets. Let's get Acts 3. Yeah, this is Acts 3 and verse 19. It says, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord, and he shall send Yahushua Mashiach, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things which the Most High have spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, a prophet shall the Lord your power raise up unto you of your brethren, like unto me. Him shall you hear in all things whatsoever he shall say unto you. And it shall come to pass that every soul which will not hear that prophet shall be destroyed from among the people. All right? So you better hearken unto his voice. So through the process of elimination, that angel got to be referring to the Messiah, is not Michael the Archangel. All right, he doesn't, that's not his task. All right, his job is to protect Israel. He fights our battles, you know, in the spirit. He fights with other you know, demons and, you know, left hand angels. Okay? So this guy is off, you know, and if you ever, you know, hear this argument, well, now you understand. Okay, this is not talking about Michael the Archangel. All right. And you know, there's other things I could have, you know, went into, you know, like going back to Joshua and how when he told Israel to basically be of good courage. Well, did not Yahushua also say the same thing to his disciples when he warned them that they was gonna go into there's gonna be a time of tribulation, but he told them to be of good courage because he got the victory. So just as Joshua gave Israel good courage that we were gonna win and we were gonna take the land of Canaan and we were gonna be successful because the Lord's gonna be with us, the Lord did the same thing, all right, with his disciples. All right, showing that the Lord, you know, was more than likely watching over Joshua. And for him to make that same statement that Joshua made to Israel, hey, that's, you know, I'm just comparing spiritual things with spiritual. All right, be of good cheer, overcame the world. Okay. But anyway, I'm gonna end off with that. I'm gonna give all praise, glory, and honor to Yahweh Bashem Yahushai, and until the next lesson. Say Shalom.